time of radical change. And at that time, a child named Shireen was born to an Iranian Baha'i couple in Bombay. And this child was to be part of and influence that change. Shireen was born in a society where women had few rights, were unlearned, and even downtrodden. But things were different in her family. Their Baha'i faith taught equal rights for men and women. Shireen was given opportunities that most women didn't have. Her parents educated her and allowed her to voice her opinions. At 16, Shireen gave her maiden public speech at the town hall in Karachi. Her speech on universal education was reported in the press as the first time an Asian woman had addressed a public gathering in the East. It was a glowing start to Shireen's long career in motivating and galvanizing people to improve things wherever she went. In India, Southeast Asia, Indochina, Australia, New Zealand, and the US. Shireen was concerned about women's position in society. She saw the ignorance, the biases, the constraints, and the restrictions against women. Shireen advocated improving things for women. She believed the woman is the family's bedrock and the first educator of children. She enlisted the help and support of people from all levels to highlight her concerns. The wealthy, the influential, the selfless. Shireen's own family was her strongest support. Since their wedding in 1925, Shireen's husband had encouraged her activities. When Shireen came to Singapore with her husband in 1950, she already had a reputation. She was the woman with a message. Seeing a need for change, Shireen first galvanized other like-minded women. With about 2,000 of them, Shireen formed the Singapore Council of Women in 1952 and became its first Secretary General. But Shireen's philosophy was that real equality comes when men and women work together. So she did not restrict her efforts to just the ladies. Shireen approached the political parties standing in Singapore's first election. The PAP took up her cause, and One Man, One Wife was at the top of its manifesto. In 1961, the Women's Charter was established. The law changed the lives of women in Singapore and neighboring countries where its principles were adopted. Shireen did not rest on her laurels. She took her efforts to Thailand, where she wanted to improve the lot of girls there, to prevent them from becoming prostitutes. Shireen set up the Santitam School in Yasothon Town, a poverty-ridden area in northeast Thailand. She invited the Thai princess to open the school and gained the support of the Thai government and education officials. Today, the school is the best in the region. Shireen was a woman who created opportunities. When she wanted to open up a market for handicrafts made by Thai girls and women, she approached the people who could make that possible.
I couldn't say no. When I met her, she was very slight, bent, but there is a compassion about the way she was expressing herself and the needs of these village women and the passion for the kind of work she did.
Shireen Fozdar was a catalyst for many things we take for granted today. She is an example of women, many of whom have worked silently, unrecognized, rarely acknowledged, to build a place we today call home. It is through the work of these women that today the fairer sex can come to the forefront, to take their place as equal partners in Singapore's development and success.
Good afternoon. Mr. Ho Kok Ping, Chairman of Singapore Management University Board of Directors, Professor Arnold De Meyer, President of Singapore Management University, Professor Lily Kong, Provost of Singapore Management University, Dr. Noeleen Heyzer, former Undersecretary General of the United Nations, Ms. Claire Chung, Senior Vice President and Co-Founder of Banyan Tree Corporate Private Limited and Chairperson of the Shirin Fozdar Program. Distinguished guests, my name is Yashvi Munka and I am a Shirin Fozdar scholar and also a year one student with SMU School of Accountancy. I have been in Singapore for a month now and I like the place and the people tremendously. Welcome to the inaugural Shirin Fozdar Program annual lecture. The Shirin Fozdar Program was first established in honor of Mrs. Shirin Fozdar, a pioneer of women's rights in Singapore. To kick off this event, Ms. Claire Chung, chairperson of Shirin Fozdar Program, will deliver her welcome address. Ms. Claire Chung is the co-founder and senior vice president of Banyan Tree Holdings. She is also the chairperson of Banyan Tree Global Foundation, the sustainability arm of the group. Ms. Chung was awarded in 1998 as a Woman of the Year for her contribution to community. She served as a Singapore-nominated Member of Parliament for two terms, 1997 to 2001, where she raised many policy issues related to the social service sector, women, family, education, and the disadvantaged. Ladies and gentlemen, may I now invite Ms. Claire Chung on stage. Ms. Chung, please.
Distinguished community guests of honor, you are all my guests of honor. I hope you enjoyed the video. It was my late father-in-law, Mr. Ho Rih Hwa, who introduced Mrs. Fozdar to me 3 decades ago. He supported her causes in Yasaton by donating typewriters, scholarships, and vehicles. In the late 80s, Mrs. Fozdar took an overnight bus to meet me in Bangkok to ask me to buy 2 cushions made in Yasaton, you know, the typical triangular cushions from Thailand. She told me 2 cushions could help to place a girl in school. That lifted my eyes to village craft as a viable revenue source in creating educational opportunities for girls. I quit teaching at NUS and started the retail business in Banyan Tree, promoting vanishing craft and handiwork. I believe, like Mrs. Fozdar, that education and employment are the best safeguards against prostitution and poverty. 2 cushions started my journey in business. My daughter, Ren Yong, who joined Banyan Tree, continues with this legacy of upholding the pride of craft. Mrs. Shirin Fozdar was a leader who believed in service to others. She's a humanist, transcending time, cultures, and place, respecting people for what they are. She's scholarly, yet able to relate to the common folks. She was a peacemaker, always appreciating a cup half full, and always finding more water to help fill up the cup to full. She sometimes finds men annoying. She said, but she told me once, slowly and steadily, like the bird's 2 wings, the male and female must beat in unison to find the balance to soar higher. This insight had guided me in shaping the spirit in community building. The Shirin Fozdar Program was first launched in May 1993 as a trust by the then President of Singapore, the late Dr. Wee Kim Wee. Dr. Kanwaljit Soin, who is here today, was a key driver in setting this up while I was president of AWARE. If you all know Kani, she makes people work with her and well. Thank you, Kani. Let's give her a round of applause. For 16 years, it was run independently as a trust fund, and finally in 2009, we institutionalized this fund as a program with Singapore Management University to leverage the resources of SMU to sustain this initiative while motivating SMU undergraduates and faculty to think beyond business and management. We set up Shirin Fozdar grants to students with the best of most innovative idea for a community service project that enhances community capability. We hope they understand their leadership role is about doing good while doing well. That while creating wealth to also value add by positively transforming society for the better. We should be proud of our students in SMU. They built libraries, saved shelters, provided orphans and with clothes, and they taught girls how to speak English, and they sought for medical help for mothers with HIV and many other causes. From the founding of this fund in the 90s till today, the fund supported more than 50 projects for 40-some social service agencies in Singapore and the region, and as far as India, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Kenya. Currently, instead of holding conferences in SMU, we organize conferences on the move, to be short, COM, COM, to learn from experts and share our women's perspectives. Our activities included visiting Bukit Ho Swee neighborhood one-room rental apartments. And this was led by Beyond Services by Gerardi, a community service agency, to understand how residents cope with the living standards and what can we do more. Also included visits to Susan Chong's Green Pack, who offer customized solutions to help companies switch to environmentally friendly packaging while reducing wastage, achieving bottom line cost savings and supply chain efficiency. We also visited architectural firm like ADP to look at planning guidelines and share the woman's perspective on how a city should deliver its promise to create value in quality living for all. We asked a very simple question: where are the women's views? What are their inputs? And where's the women's perspectives on all issues? The COM program is living education and brain work. It is also about fellowship and network. By organizing signature lectures such as this today and various other networking activities throughout the year, SFP serves as a platform to connect stakeholders at all levels and from all walks of life in fostering a resilient community and nurturing integrative perspectives on development. I'd like to call on my board to stand up to be recognized for working so hard with me on this initiative. Prof. Arnold, Priyanka, Professor Lilika. This September 29th to 30th, we shall partner with the Federation of Asia Pacific Women's Association in an international conference led by Sarah Wu, which as part of our efforts in strategic networking and regional collaborations. And in November, we'll visit Trehas, a social enterprise funded and run by Elaine Kim and her team, capable young women who are determined to find solutions to help women stay at work while having children, is work-life integration in action. And we have currently launched a research project on gender and family care for Asian elderly in comparative perspective. The scholars were both here. Kun Busaravan, please, and Christine. They will share their findings next year in a conference in 2017, yeah. And so please visit our website. There are so many programs there about our past, our present, and our future. And please do not miss our WOW Cyberspace Library. It's called Women of the World Library. It curates articles, research papers, and book titles for all to access. And of course, the most exciting thing this, and this is clearly pushed by Prof. Arnold, is our Shirin Fozdar Diversity and Inclusion Award this year, which will recognize and celebrate an individual's or group's innovative contribution to the enhancement of diversity and inclusion in the campus and in the community. And of course, we are very pleased to welcome our first two Shirin Fozdar scholars. You heard Yashvi Munkar just now, who is studying in the School of Accountancy, and the other is Miss Kwanti Tuan An from Vietnam, studying in Lee Kong Chian School of Business. They've been here barely 2 months, but you ask them the social services they have done in Singapore, it will shame us. They've been visiting homes, they are doing services during the weekends, and they're engaged in work like today. So this is work. So we are here building on the successes of generations of women to forge alliances with our men to create greater social impact. Someone was very surprised that the men were here. Very often SFP programs have men and women. I would really like to register my thanks to Professor Arnold for his inspiring leadership. And also for Professor Lily Kong for joining in to lend us your guidance and leadership. And today, I have the utmost pleasure to introduce to you an eminent daughter of Singapore, Dr. Noeleen Heyzer, and a dear friend. She was the first woman to serve as the Executive Secretary of the UN Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific since its founding in 1947. She's the first woman from outside North America to head the UN Development Fund for Women, UNIFEM, becoming its longest serving executive director for 13 years between 1994 and 2007. She's the first woman to receive the Eminent Alumni Award from the National University of Singapore in 2014. She's also the first international recipient of the Alata Jacobs Prize in 2014, University of Groningen, Netherlands. Ooh, it's long. Amidst these firsts, there were many more local and international awards Noeleen had received. The one I'd like to mention was the Dag Hammarskjöld Medal in 2004 for her work on women, peace, and security. What a tremendous achievement. I've known Noeleen for decades. The one memory I remembered best was meeting her in her home in Brighton, where she was teaching at the University of Sussex, where she told KP and I how she had to rely on the oven heat to keep warm during the cold winters, especially for her twin daughters, Pauline and Lillian. I was awe-stricken by this smart, level-headed, kind, and never-say-die life warrior. Our conversations were always around gender matters framed within the context of broader development concerns on sustainability and its purpose, the appropriate structure and processes, the meaning and purpose of development, for whom, why, and how. What roles do women play in this transformation? What are the paradigm shifts we have to make? How do we manage and actualize pluralism? What kind of partnerships do we forge to scale up possibilities, and who define the purpose of development? Paradigms, pluralism, partnership, possibilities, and purpose. The five P's guiding my evaluation project on projects. We obviously always have more questions than answers, but these questions have to be continually raised and addressed from an integrated perspective to harmonize the needs of the individual men and women, old and young, and the expectations of the larger society. We hope to take some lesson points today. And if you see at your brochure, there is a tagline below which establishes our spirit of SFP. Ignite the flame within us to light up the paths for others. Let us put our hands together to welcome Dr. Noeleen Heyzer, who is one of those women who light up the paths for others. Our keynote speaker for our inaugural Shirin Fozdar program.
Very good afternoon, everyone. And dear Claire, thank you so much for that very, very, very kind introduction. Mr. Ho Kwong Pin, Chairman of SMU, Professor Arnold Demeyer, President of SMU, Madam Provost, Professor Lily Kong, Madam Claire Chiang, Chair of the Shirin Fozdar Program, family members of Shirin Fozdar, dear colleagues, dear students, and dear friends. Let me first congratulate SMU for that extremely successful Horo Hua lecture delivered by the Secretary General of the United Nations. I'm sure many of you were there. And I must say that the Secretary General was extremely pleased with that lecture and was very impressed by the SMU students and by the youth of Singapore. He said they asked him questions from which he was still sweating. but I'm glad that he heard all our concerns and also felt what Singapore has become. But today I'm deeply honoured to deliver this inaugural lecture to remember and celebrate the life of Shirin Fozdar. And you've already seen what type of a woman she is. Shirin Fozdar is best remembered for me as a fearless and outspoken advocate of women's human rights. Born in India, she worked on women's dignity and rights in 1930s and 1940s already, focusing on equality and peace. And in 1950, she and her husband moved to Singapore to help spread the Baha'i teaching, one of which is the fundamental equality between women and men. When the Fozdars arrived, colonial Singapore, with its poor migrant population, was a very different place. It was not the stable and prosperous country that we know today. It had a history of young girls sold for silver, which is the title of the powerful autobiography by Janet Lim. Or they were given away as muichai, or bonded girls. In the context of grinding poverty, the alternative to selling was to abandon newborn infants if they were girls. Many newborn girls were left at the doorsteps of convents or in rubbish bins to die. In fact, the Victoria Street Convent that today is Chimes was actually the orphanage where many girls were left in the dustbins. Polygamy was common. Many women and young girls were easily discarded, left in very distressful and vulnerable situations with no legal rights and protection. The situation appalled Shirin Fozdar, and she focused her energy on advocating for a better legal framework for women and girls and waging a campaign against polygamy and child marriage. I will not go through how she did it, as you saw in her video, but that led very much to the Women's Charter in 1961. But our women pioneers, and I was very impressed, I didn't know that she was able to mobilize 2,000 women at that time to set up the Singapore Women's Council. And I thought that was extremely impressive. But these women pioneers, the 2,000 women together with her, knew that legal rights would remain paper rights unless women were empowered to claim these rights, to make choices, and to shape their future. And they believed in the power of education for girls to have access to new and better opportunities, empowering girls to have employable skills, as Claire has mentioned. And in 1953, actually, Shirin Fozdar initiated Singapore's first girl club at Joo Chiat Welfare Centre to teach women and girls English and mathematics. How very practical. And in 1961, she moved to Thailand, as we have heard from Claire. So I congratulate SMU for housing the Shirin Fozdar program. And my dear friend Claire, you have really been the forefront of many, many things. And for you to chair this program has been very special. By doing so, you're keeping alive the legacy of a dedicated leader who was relentless in the pursuit of justice, freedom, and equality for women. She was a pioneer who changed the circumstances of women in her adopted country, Singapore. She then continued to make positive change so that many women and girls could live more meaningful and fulfilling lives in our region. Ladies and gentlemen, our world is a better place because so many women dared to transform their own lives and live beyond fear, to be at the forefront of change, empowering others through their voices and through their voice and bold actions to improve the lives of women in powerful ways. Unfortunately, history has not sufficiently acknowledged the contribution of these women, and I'm so glad that our other hero, Dr. Kangi Soin, together with Margaret Thomas, produced Our Lives to Live, putting a woman's face to change in Singapore as Singapore turned 50. I'm glad that the Singapore Council of Women's Organization, through the Singapore Hall of Fame, is celebrating the lives of many women who have broken what were once thought to be unbreakable barriers. Let me put the spotlight on just a few pioneer women in Singapore and beyond, many of whom I've had the honor of working with or being influenced by. So you know Shirin Fozdar, but I thought Elizabeth Choi, a war hero, but also a political leader who was one of the two women heading our Legislative Council, making policies that influence people's lives. And actually her daughter, I'm not sure whether you're here, Bridget, are you here? There, yeah, her daughter is still here. Thank you, Bridget, for coming. Yeah. Janet Lim, I've mentioned her with her book that was called Soul for Silver. She broke the silence on sexual violence and really moved on to become the matron of Singapore's first hospital. And my dearest friend, the Assistant High Commissioner of Refugees, is here today under the same name, and she was influenced by Janet Lim. So Janet Lim, please stand up as well. I met Rosa Parks, and she refused to give up her seat and catalyzed a whole civil rights movement. And someone said to me, Rosa Parks sat so that Martin Luther King can walk and Obama can run and see what happened up to the White House and became such a wonderful president. You may not know these people, but I've worked with them. Sakina was a founder of an education movement in Afghanistan, trying to repair the broken landscape after the rule of the Taliban that prevented young girls from going to schools. And she and her friends started homeschools for girls at the worst of time. And I, of course, had the opportunity of working very closely with her. And this is one of my dearest friend, Ella Bhatt, who actually was a union organizer, but she did not just organize women at doing a formal job. Her focus was actually on casual, informal workers, the Self-Employed Women's Association. So I put this up, because at the end of the day, you can see that it's not just one or two, but there's a whole movement of women. The list of women who dared to transform lives and society is endless. It includes the women in the suffragette movement in the late 19th century and early 20th century who fought for political voice and the right to vote, to the women who organized for peace and bread against World War I, to the women who changed the working and living condition for women textile workers, remembered on every International Women's Day. They all shared some common attributes: their courage to break barriers and entrench discrimination, to create breakthroughs that unlock the potential and creativity of women and girls, especially from vulnerable backgrounds. Their determination to succeed in the fight for legal, social and economic equality despite strong resistance. They're outraged by injustice and their leadership to give voice to the voiceless and mobilize for change in the public mindset, in policies, in institutions and practices. They committed their lives to shaping a world where all girls, independent of background, could be educated, could have economic power, could have legal rights to fulfill their dreams, to improve the quality of their lives and that of their society. These tenacious women are social entrepreneurs, relentless in their pursuit of a world where every girl is wanted, valued, and loved, where every life counts. So, where are we on gender equality in Asia? In Asia, striving for inclusive societies founded on equality, justice, and rights is unfinished business. Gender inequality still remains a barrier to progress and social stability and deprives the region of its full human potential. Yes, Asia has transformed itself over the last four decades. It has reduced by more than half the population living in poverty from 52% in 1990 to just 18% in 2012. It has created an educated and an expanding middle class that is technologically savvy and that have taken advantage of new opportunities. It has generated rapid and sustained economic growth, and prosperity was widely shared. And this is indeed the crux of the Asian miracle. The generation of shared prosperity and the reduction of poverty in the shortest period of human history. Yet, in many countries and communities, gender inequality remains entrenched, even in this era of rapid economic transformation. Yes, in our region as a whole, women are living longer lives, are better educated, more women are participating in the economy, and Asia has the second highest ratio of employed women of working age in the world at 49%. More women are leaders in the corporate world. A handful of countries are narrowing the gender gap in political participation. Asian countries, as members of the United Nations, have made formal commitments to implement CEDAW. Yet, despite these achievements, Asia lags behind on several aspects of gender equality compared to other developing regions. Great disparities exist between our sub-regions. Whilst many parts of East and Southeast Asia are moving forward, progress is too slow in South Asia. Indeed, ranking on gender equality indicators developed by UNDP Human Development Report shows that many parts of South Asia are close to or even lower than sub-Saharan Africa when it comes to health, adult literacy, economic participation. Poverty has a woman's face, not only because of discrimination in earnings, but also due to women's inability to access economic opportunities because of entrenched discriminatory structures and practices that restricts women's mobility and threatens their security, limit their employment choices, reduce their inheritance rights, and control over assets. Progress for women is too slow when Asia has the highest male-female sex ratio in the world, with sex-selective abortion and female infanticide, resulting in a lopsided population of about 100 million missing women in China and India. Progress is too slow when maternal mortality and other gender-related MDGs are the hardest to achieve in so many communities. There is no progress when girls are still given away in child marriage or as debt payment, and girls like Malala are shot or kidnapped for wanting an education. And all this happens to be in our region. There is no progress when over 1,000 women garment workers lose their lives with the collapse of Rana Plaza in Bangladesh because of poor working conditions. And I know that you, Fui Shun, that you were so much on the front line of the labor movement here in Singapore. Thank you, and a big applause. Today, violence against women continues to destroy the lives and talents of far too many women and girls. There are about 500 honor killings a year by family members in Pakistan alone. Rape still continues to be used as a weapon of war in far too many conflict-affected communities, and women are still excluded from the peace and decision-making tables. These are just glimpses of how women and girls are still devalued in society, and the inability of society to provide them with basic human security. They are violations of women's basic human rights. Much more must be done, and done urgently. And that is why I join the United Nations. The Charter of the United Nations was written whilst the world was engulfed in the horror of the Second World War. Faced with untold sorrow and the potential of human self-destruction, we are very great at destroying ourselves. Women leaders were determined that never again should our world be destroyed by injustice, hatred, and violence. Established in the name of We the Peoples, it entered into force on the 24th of October, 1945, with the promise of a just and better world, free from want, free from fear, free from all forms of discrimination, not just for the present generation, but for all future generations. The Nobel laureate Ralph Bunche, who was closely involved in the drafting of the Charter, wrote, and I quote him, "The United Nations exists not merely to preserve the peace, but also to make change, even radical change, possible without violent upheaval." I've worked for almost 30 years in the United Nations, and over the course of these three decades, I've learned time and again the truth of Ralph Bunche's words. The United Nations has global legitimacy and is a purpose-driven organization based on the principles and values of the UN Charter. Because of these principles, the UN has moral authority, can give voice to the voiceless, and defend the defenseless. I fully believe in the founding principles of the United Nations, which is why I have spent most of my life in its service, leading change whenever there was an opportunity. In 1994, I was recruited as the executive director of the UN Women's Fund to lead the fund in the global preparation for the Fourth World Conference for Women in Beijing. My strategy from the very start was a focus on nurturing women's leadership and agency to make change happen using the UN Charter and human rights instruments as normative and analytical framework for fighting against discrimination and injustices and holding our governments and systems accountable. And I thought I'll share this picture. Oh, sorry, it's too fast. Okay, this is at the Fourth World Conference on Women, and I am wondering whether you recognize this person. Well, she has now broken the ultimate glass ceiling in terms of running for presidency, and hopefully she will shatter all the glass ceilings and the sticky floors if she gets elected. This is Alabat. So, and next to me, which you can't see, but you can see his name, is Muhammad Yunus. So really, at the Beijing conference, it was mobilizing people from the ground, like Ella, at the very top with influence, like Hillary Clinton, the men who we saw as supporting us, and it was really turning everything around. And in fact, one of her campaign message is precisely from this conference, which is, do you all know it? Women's rights are human rights, exactly. And this is what she's been running for. Well, a lot of the work that we have done supported women's leadership and networks at all levels to establish and implement legal frameworks to inform and shape public policies, to build effective institutions that deliver for people, to generate political space and voice, to expand access and opportunity, especially for vulnerable women and girls. Where these strategies have worked, they have brought transformations in the way we live our lives. They have improved women's legal, social, economic, and political status. And I have witnessed how they have changed family and property laws, established model employment contracts for domestic workers, make violence against women a legal offense, increase women's political participation and decision-making, make rape in war zones a crime against humanity. But unfortunately, tonight, there's only time to share just one example of being at the forefront of these changes through the United Nations. So let me focus on UNIFEM's work to combat violence against women around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, violence against women is a universally devastating and often unpunished crime. It transcends all boundaries, and its exorbitant human and economic costs have yet to be calculated. Today, the World Bank estimates that violence against women is as serious a cause of death and incapacity as cancer, and a greater cause of ill health than traffic accidents and malaria combined. Worldwide, UN figures indicate that one in every three women has experienced violence in her lifetime, most often by someone she knows. Yet, just over two decades, 20 years ago, the issue of gender-based violence was a silent and hidden phenomena, regarded largely as a private matter, and did not merit the attention of the governments, nor of the United Nations system itself. It was only in 1993 that the UN Declaration on the Elimination of Violence Against Women became the first international human rights instrument to deal specifically with violence against women. The World Conference on Human Rights affirmed the same year that violence against women contravenes human rights norms, making states and the international community accountable. Other world conferences that followed made the link between eliminating violence and women's progress unquestionably clear. Using the momentum of the UN world conferences, UNIFEM immediately started a series of UN system-wide regional campaigns under the name Lives Free of Violence, It's Our Right, to revise discriminatory laws, to introduce new legislation, to strengthen enforcement, to educate and change mindsets, and to mobilize more sectors of the population around this issue globally. At its launch, a journalist asked me, "You must be joking. Do you really believe that a problem as common and as widespread as violence against women can be brought to an end?" My response to this is a definite yes. Yes, we dare to embark on it. Yes, we dare to imagine a world free of violence against women and be at the forefront to bring this change about. Yes, it can be stopped if promises made by our governments at UN conferences are kept and turned into reality. Today, the pandemic of violence against women has been brought from the margins of silence into the center of national and global policy making, and features on the agenda of almost every government of the world, as well as of the United Nations and other multilateral organizations. UNIFEM is proud to have played a pivotal role in the struggle to bring violence against women to the forefront as a human rights issue, a public health issue, and as a developmental issue. We are proud to have supported a forceful women's movement, organizing and mobilizing at local, national, and international levels. We are proud to have provided advice and technical assistance to our governments and institutions, helping to turn commitments into reality. We are encouraged that many men, including those at the highest political level, have come forward around this agenda and mobilized other men. Let me just capture our role being at the forefront of this change. We mobilized and used campaigns and media to reach hearts and minds and to help establish an environment that is conducive for ending gender-based violence in almost every region of the world. They awakened the consciousness of millions worldwide to this critical issue, mobilizing new constituencies and generating strengthened political will. However, mobilization and campaigns alone are not enough. I worked with our member states to allocate new resources and created the United Nations Trust Fund to eliminate all forms of violence against women, and this was established by the UN General Assembly. With this, we were able to further bolster the advocacy efforts undertaken through the campaigns by catalyzing and supporting concrete programs on the ground. And this added to the momentum and helped to forge new partnerships with new constituencies, including at the municipalities. I went ahead of myself. The media, youth, and men's groups united to find solutions to specific problems. We were able to finance and link many local initiatives to national efforts and the global movement against violence. We could show the result of this effort community by community, region by region. For example, in the Caribbean, the Women's Crisis Centers began to work with police departments to improve their response to cases of violence against women. In Jordan, the media broke the traditional silence on the crime of honor killing of women suspected of adultery. The issue was subsequently addressed by our goodwill ambassador, Princess Basma, and discussed in Parliament. In Senegal, a groundbreaking law banning female genital mutilation was implemented together with a campaign to educate the public on the harmful consequences of the practice with the help of religious leaders. Working with the support of the United Nations Secretary General at that time, Mr. Kofi Annan, the President of the World Bank, and leaders such as President Nelson Mandela, we were able to harness political will and create collective power. And I'll show you the next. Okay, oops, that's too fast again. For the first time in the history of the United Nations, thousands of women and men, young and old, gathered in the UN General Assembly on International Women's Day, March 8, 1999, for a global video conference that celebrated some of the most inspiring stories from the fight against violence. So you see Kofi Annan here. Do you know her? You may not be able to see her very clearly. Glenn Close. This is for those who are in the environment field and sustainable development field. You know Gus Beth, who is now one of the presidents of Yale College, Yale University. But spearheaded by UNIFEM, this event was the first ever held in the whole General Assembly in the history of the United Nations. The event linked government leaders, top UN decision makers and advocates in the General Assembly to sites in Africa, Asia, Latin America and Europe. Together, they shared the many successful community, national and global initiatives that are achieving the goal of eliminating all forms of violence against women. And they learned of successful examples that can be replicated and upscaled across our regions. In preparation for this video conference, of course, we also used the ICT. Now, the political will and the resources and action, the collective power described above, have generated a strong momentum to end violence against women. However, the work is incomplete. The challenge is to ensure sustained action. As a response to the UNIFEM call at this conference, the governments of the world passed a UN General Assembly resolution introduced by the Dominican Republic that designated the 25th of November as the International Day to Eliminate Violence Against Women. And every year, the global women's movement marked this day till the Human Rights Day on the 10th of December as 16 days of activism to end a tragic epidemic that devastates the lives of women and girls. However, ladies and gentlemen, Violence in women's lives and that of their children will not be eradicated until all members of society refuse to tolerate it every day. From UNIFEM's work and that of our partners, we have learned that a world free from violence against women requires a multiplicity of strategies that must be sustained and carried out by many actors, including governments, civil societies, and the media. And we and our partners, therefore, focus on the following key areas, often ignored, but which together have made change happen, yet require much more investment, supporting research and documentation. The data, the statistics, the personal stories are still very lacking, and we need to capture them. Two, we have also supported reviewing our legislation and adopting UN frameworks, encouraging our government to review discriminatory legislation and, where necessary, adopt new laws based on the UN frameworks aimed at ending violence against women. Providing support services. No amount of education or legislation on gender-based violence can be effective if services to attend to the different needs of survivors are not also financed and put in place. Creating community responsibilities. Efforts at building community response to violence against women have a preventive effect and in the long run holds the most promise. Prevention, prevention, prevention. Changing institutional attitudes. Changing how women are viewed by officials charged with responding to the needs of women who experience violence is an area of major concern for those working towards the elimination of violence against women. Changing male behavior. The last few years, we have witnessed the emergence of groups of men speaking out against violence against women. And I have to say that what we accept in times of peace worsen in times of war or humanitarian crises. Many conflicts target women and girls from Bosnia, Rwanda, Liberia, from the DRC to Timor-Leste, places that I've worked. Rape was always used as a weapon of war to destroy not just women, but to destroy communities and to traumatize them beyond recovery. The international community, and this is the last part of my lecture, I wanted to focus on towards a more secure and sustainable world. The international community today recognizes that efforts to confront gender-based violence are central to human security. And this is why I mentioned it today. It is central to human security and development more than ever today. Today, we are witnessing new threats to human and global security. The growing influence of extremists, national and transnational forces, are working to close down democratic spaces and mobilize against the ethos of our society, against human rights, especially women's human rights and dignity. In many parts of the world, the gains made to improve women's lives are now under attack, or have been lost because of growing violent extremisms, or because of protracted conflicts, or because of humanitarian crises. We have already witnessed how threats to all our security intensified to the breaking point when we ignore abuses to women's human rights. Before the September 11 terror attack in New York, international community failed to act meaningfully when Afghan girls were prohibited from going to school, when Afghan women doctors and teachers were prohibited from going to work, when women were beaten for what they wore. What happened to women in Afghanistan was often regarded as a women's issue, or an issue of tradition or culture, or a problem that needed to be dealt with in the private sphere. On the contrary, especially after we worked with Security Council Resolution 1325, what happened in Afghanistan demonstrated that the way in which a country or community treats women and protects and promotes their human rights is one of the best early warning indicators of the state of governance. is respect for international norms and standards. And that is why we worked with the Security Council on Women, Peace and Security, resulting in the Security Council Resolution 1325. It promotes the human rights of women in conflict-affected countries, emphasizing prevention and protection and women's rights in participation, peace building, and recovery. Just last two pictures. This is some of the work that we did in Rwanda after the violence. It is hard to actually even explain that the women who experienced violence of the worst kind, who were infected with HIV/AIDS, who were raped because of the conflict, that they were the ones who set up centers to adopt each other's orphans. They did not ask, are you Tutsi, are you a Hutu? All they knew was that these were the children of Rwanda, and they brought hope to the orphans. And I, after visiting them, immediately got the private sector to come on board. When I went back to New York, I got all my private sector people, including the head of Macy's and Bloomingdale's. I'm sure some of you have gone shopping there. So they adopted all the work, including what I call the peace basket, because I spent evenings working with, listening to their stories. And after, there was a point beyond tears. And they told me that they came together and they told each other's story and so on. But they were, and in their discussions, they were weaving this basket. So I, at that time, then said, let's call this the peace basket. They are not just the baskets for your grain, but they should be the symbol of peace. And the fact that you dare to cross boundaries and to realize that our societies can no longer just be homogeneous societies, and we cannot create genocide anywhere else. And when I then was able to get these peace baskets to be sold in Macy's, because the CEO of Macy's was so supportive. So they became the gift for Easter. So instead of sending Easter cards or Christmas cards, people sent each other the peace baskets. And I got Nicole Kidman to go behind this. And she, again, was able to promote this. And I must say that it made such a difference. And in fact, what was so special was that it actually made such a difference, not just to these women, because it obviously brought them from the margins to the center of their society. It also generated a lot of foreign currency for the country. But what was so special, and I teasingly say this, if you teach a woman to fish, it's just, she's not just going to fish. She'll change the whole fishing industry. So let me tell you what these women did. They then employed, because there was so much demand for their baskets, so they employed the ex-combatants who had no jobs. So they employed these young men to go to look for weeds to start weaving. And then because they were weaving and they were getting all these weeds, what was seen as a wasteland and mangrove swamps and all that, but that was ecologically important for sustainability, suddenly it was restored and it was protected. And they became some people who were very, very precious to the country. The last slide that I wanted to show you was the work in Afghanistan. A lot of people, in fact, when I was trying to help to put the issue of gender equality on the evolving at that time, the new constitution of Afghanistan, I was told, what do you know? You haven't even been to Afghanistan. You don't even know what the local women want. You have only listened to the diaspora. And how do you know they want equality? It could be a cultural issue and so on. So I did a trip. And this was to get a consultation. And of course, each of these women here... Oh, sorry. So when I asked them, would you like gender equality? And they said, it's not about us. We can't remember even the day we were born. We can't even write our names, but we want to make sure that our daughters and sons are able to write theirs. And for that, I worked extremely hard, and you wouldn't believe that we were able to mobilize over 1,000 women in the burned-down cinema on International Women's Day to speak to the leaders who didn't believe that they wanted equal rights. And eventually, through the Laurel-Gilger process, is a long story, but we managed to get the equal citizenship right for women in the Constitution. Of course, that is only the first step. But the point is that it sets a standard and is a norm that people have to be held accountable for. So, we have to, ladies and gentlemen, we have to stop thinking that gender equality is a win for women and a loss for men. Gender equality benefits men as much as women, and critical to building an inclusive and secure society. Gender equality also looks at men's lives, the violence that men face, being the first to fight in conflicts and wars, the pressures of supporting extended families because of norms that regard men as a main income earner, the risks and violence that they face working in hazardous employment. Gender equality is not just about making women's lives more like or just like men's, which may not be where women want to be anyway. It is about the restructuring that advances our economic development and social progress, that allows both women and men better ways of living and interrelating in society and in the home, harnessing their full potential as people, improving their lives, expanding their opportunities, and helping societies flourish across our dynamic and thriving regions. Moving forward, it is vital to work to reduce violence, conflicts, and humanitarian crises by investing in building more inclusive and peaceful societies. The Sustainable Development Goals, adopted under the title Transforming Our World, the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda, can inspire new energy for the transformative change we want. It is a universal, integrated, and human rights-based agenda for societal transformation that simultaneously addresses economic growth, social justice, gender equality, and environmental stewardship. It highlights the link between peace, development, and human rights, and an agenda that leaves no one behind. Much, of course, depends on the successful implementation of this Sustainable Development Agenda. Responsible public-private people's partnership with mutual accountability is key to implementation. Such partnerships can only be forged if they are based on shared values, shared vision, and shared goals of placing people and planet at the center of decision-making, aligning private action and public policies to improve lives and bring about the sustainable future we want. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to act in order to prevent new problems, to find solutions to our multiple vulnerabilities, and to renew our world to be what it can be. So let me end by using an image of the bird that Claire has used as well, from the Baha'i tradition of Shirin Fozdar, that captures it all. As we prepare for the future, my hope is that with greater wisdom, and this is what humanity needs most of all at this time, with greater wisdom and more women in leadership, humanity will finally have two wings soaring in the 21st century. I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Noeleen Heyzer, for your inspirational sharing. We will now proceed to the question and answer segment. May we invite Dr. Noeleen Heyzer to please take a seat. I'd also like to invite Professor Lily Kong, Provost of Singapore Management University, who is also Singapore's first female provost, to join her on stage as the moderator. After hearing the inspirational sharing, I'm sure that you would have many questions to ask. Simply proceed to the nearest standing microphone to introduce yourself before you pose the question. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Yes, this is working. A very good afternoon to everyone, and thank you very much for coming. As you've heard, my name is Lily Kong. I'm Provost of the Singapore Management University, and yesterday I celebrated my first anniversary here. It's amazing to be sharing this stage with Noeleen. As a young undergraduate at the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences at NUS many years ago, we all heard about you and looked up to the possibility that we might walk the footsteps that you had laid ahead of us. And it's amazing to be here with you today, together with many, many women in Singapore who have played such significant roles in changing the conditions in Singapore, in the courage to make transformation possible for many children, young women, and society in general. Too many to name, but just looking across the room, I see women in who've had leadership roles in politics, in law, in medicine, in banking, in finance, in ICT. Too many to name, and too dangerous to name in case I leave anybody out. But it is amazing, and it's an honor for SMU to be hosting all of you. But it's also lovely to see in the room not just women, but men as well. Because as we heard through the video, Shirin Fozdar believed that in making real change, we need men and women to work together. And so it's a delight to see so many men in the room as well. And in a moment, I'm going to call on some of you, just to give you a heads up. It's also lovely to see that amidst the women leaders that we have, pioneers in many ways, who've charted the path for Singapore and many other parts of the world as well, we also have many young people in the room. I looked through the list of attendees, and there are students from universities, junior colleges, polytechnics, and so forth. And in a moment, too, I'm going to call on you. So I'm giving you a heads up. Think about your questions. I take the prerogative as moderator perhaps to begin so that you have a bit of time to think about what you might want to ask. In a moment, I'll come to you. But I would like to begin by asking Noeleen a question. We've had quite a lot of conversation in Singapore in recent months, in fact, in recent weeks, about whether it is conceivable that we might have a leader, a prime minister of a different race. I'm going to ask that question about gender. Do you see a time when Singapore might be led by a woman prime minister? Is that time anywhere on the horizons? And what are the conditions that would allow us to see that happen in Singapore? I'm going to leave that question with you for a moment, and I'm truly going to call on some of the young students amongst our audience in a moment to ask a question. And I'm also going to invite a man from amongst the audience, anyone, to ask a question of Dr. Noeleen Heyzer. Right? That's just a heads up. And then, of course, the rest will have a chance as well. But to my question, Noeleen.
Thank you, Lily, and congratulations. It's so lovely to be here with the first woman provost in Singapore. Well, if it's possible to have a first woman provost, why not have a first woman prime minister or president, right? It's not that women are wanting of skills or intelligence. I think we just need to make space for that intelligence and that decision-making to shine. And I think the first thing we have to do is first change even the percentage of women in boardrooms, in the corporate boardrooms. There's just 9%. But what is this? Surely you can do better, private sector people, get more women onto your boards. I think, and then also in terms of our cabinet. So I think there are many steps that we can take immediately But all this will actually affirm that women are indeed ready. In fact, you just heard the Secretary General last week when of the United Nations when he was here. You know, when I was in the UN, there was not a single woman who was SRSG. This is the Secretary General's Special Representative of conflict-affected countries, because they all thought that we were too weak to go into conflict zones, right? So, of course, but with this present Secretary General, he promoted so many women as Under-Secretary Generals, including SRSGs, and that was how I became an Under-Secretary General. So we need men to be behind this and who are really committed to doing something like this. And I know that some people are here from the Swedish mission. Your foreign minister was an SRSG. Yeah, and she was involved with dealing with the whole issue of sexual violence in conflict-affected countries. And now look at her. As a foreign minister, she's not even afraid to say, I'm actually moving forward on a feminist foreign policy. It was a laughing stock at first, but now everyone realized what it means, and they appreciate it so very much.
Thank you for that, Noeleen. I'm going to turn to the young people in the room, and that's, of course, everybody, but the younger people in the room. Students amongst you, you have a question? Yes. Could you hold that for a moment? We'll see if we can give if there's any student in the room who's interested to ask a question. If not, I will come back to the two hands in a moment. Where are the students? Yes.
I'm Martha. I go to Tanglin Trust School in Singapore. I was just wondering, because you touched on the issue of enabling women to work through maternity leave. I was wondering what your opinion is on trying to equalize paternity leave with maternity, like if you think that this is a viable solution or like some kind of tag team system where you can sort of take a bit of each other's leave, if that makes sense. And so to what extent do you think this is a good idea?
Dr. Heyzer, thank you very much for coming and speaking. It's definitely very inspiring for all of us to hear. I was also very moved about all the things that you were talking about in conflict zones and in areas all around the world. And I think today on social media, we are constantly bombarded with a lot of stories, press about conflict zones in Syria, Syrian refugee crisis, Yazidi women being raped, and just a lot of negativity in the world. And I think there's a lot of sense of helplessness about us not being able to do anything effectively. So based on your experience, is there anything tangible or substantive that we as individuals here in a very comfortable Singapore are able to take to make some sort of impact or difference in the world as a whole?
Yeah. Hi, I'm not a student, but my name is Trina and I'm from Denmark. Thank you for your very inspirational talk. In Denmark, we actually have a female head of states. We have a queen. We had a female president. We have a Danish ambassador here in Singapore. My question is, and I'm coming from completely neutral grounds here, and with all respect, do you believe that some of the Asian values that we see here are enabling or limiting women's rights?
Hi, good evening, Dr. Heyzer. My name's Anna. I'm actually from SMU. My question is, I organize a community service project to a center in Manila that it's a shelter for sexually and domestically abused girls, 6 to 18 years old. And I just wanted to ask, you know, as a normal student, not a celebrity or anything, what advice do you have to empower and inspire these girls to take control of their lives and kind of get to a better place? They're also involved in handicrafts, so I wonder if Ms. Claire Chiang also has any comments about that. So, yeah, that was my question. Thank you.
Thank you.
The first question on paternal leave, I think it's a very good idea for men to have the experience of parenting. Because I think they're missing out on a lot of things. They need to be fathers. And children need to have fathers. as much as mothers. So that is something that is, I think, requires more of a mindset shift. And it makes better people, I must say. And I also realize that the younger men are insisting that that's their right to be a parent. In terms of leave, I think we're talking about actually the care economy. Where are we now in terms of taking care of the aging, the childcare, and so on? We are an aging population, and increasingly, we cannot leave this just to women. We need to make sure that the private sector, the government, there's equal sharing of understanding, because we need to give value to caring. Caring is nurturing. Can you imagine if you don't have a caring framework or the architecture for caring? I mean, how can you talk about having an inclusive, caring society? So if we want to have endearing homes, endearing countries, and so on, I think that it is absolutely critical. And it's not just the responsibility of governments. I think it's the responsibility of the private sector. Because as long as employment, hiring, promotion is based on the fact that we do not recognize the value of care, you are not going to change that paradigm. And I think that at the end of the day, we started it where it was possible in the United Nations to bring children to the workplace. You know, there's a crash and this and that. So that you begin to be, it becomes to be natural to see children. You know, it's not someone to hide until you become adults and productive economic agents. You know, so basically, you begin to instill the sense of having a more integrated society where you value a lot of different aspects of building that up. Let me start, and I'll come back to the crisis one later, about Asian values. Several years ago, was asked to acknowledge the Ibsen, because it was this was the writer from Norway, since you're coming from the Scandinavian countries. So Ibsen, you know, did The Doll's House and really tried to break the facade of so many dynamics that was going on behind the walls. And in The Doll's House, you know that Nora left home as a liberation and went out into society. But it was in Asia that Lu Xun, who partnered with Ibsen, said something that was even deeper. He said, there's no point Nora leaving home if society is not fit for her. If society cannot provide her with economic empowerment and respect and dignity, she will have to get back to where she started, or even worse. So it's not about Asian values. I think there are so many Asian values that are so positive. It's really, what is it you want to choose? If you want discrimination, there are lots of practices of discrimination around. If you want transformation and liberation and even ways of dealing with the well-being of people, there are so many wonderful practices around. About the crisis, well, it is true. I mean, the world is not in a good shape. There are protracted crises. The nature and the landscape of conflicts have changed. You can't identify once and for all who the rebels are, who the fighters are. They go into your internet, they recruit people, they're more amorphous. So it is getting to be relatively scary, because you can be recruited in your home through the internet, as we have seen. So I think there's a lot that we can do in order to prevent violent extremisms of all sorts. And we need to be able to form a community that is able to include other people. A lot of the of 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 the alienation that takes place in our society has got to be addressed, and has to be, and the grievances also addressed. But at the same time, you know, and Janet Lim is here, you know, today we have about 65 million people who are displaced, who are internally displaced, who are refugees, and there are much that we can do to try to help some of them. And in fact, my own daughter has been helping and doing so much work, and not just at the site of the conflict and so on, but when these people are looking for jobs, for getting integrated, for starting to be educated and so on. And then and the other, so there's a lot which we can actually do. And I think some of the other young people I know who did this Refugee Aware Week, they're also here. About the girls, how do we make sure that the girls feel empowered? I think the narrative is very important. I think we should not be making the girls or the women who experience violence as just victims. They need to understand that they're not alone, and that so many people have experienced violence in different ways, including the men. I was recently shocked at the stories that have come out about how men, as many, quite a lot of them, and I don't have to go into details, have experienced violence in their own lives, right? So I think the issue is, how do we reduce the level of violence and to make that, and really make the perpetrators of those of violence the guilty, disempowered ones. And really, the people who have experienced violence, they can heal. The human spirit has known to heal, to be empowered, and this is something which we can do. I just want to recognize Anama Tan, because she has been working very much on CEDAW and to end all forms of discrimination against women, and Trina as well. And Sudha Naya as well. Sudha. Yes. Oh, I just read you won the World Women of the Year award. Thank you. I just saw your story, and I was very, very impressed with all the things which you are doing. So the more we act, it's like little drops of water creating a tide. And I think that each one of us should feel that we are empowered to contribute and to change the world.
Thank you for that. I've just had a card flashed at me that says 5 minutes, and I see at least 3 hands around the room and still no men. But nevertheless, would you like to ask your question? Yes, would you like to ask your question and then you? Yes? Oh, right. How did I miss you? Sorry, Zainal. Give him a warm round of applause.
Thank you.
Perhaps we'll let him ask the question first, and then you, and then this young lady, and Trina. Last 4 questions. That's all the time we have for Zainal.
I suppose after asking a question whether the Prime Minister can be a woman, I suppose it's not appropriate for me to say ladies first, right?
Not in this context, I think.
Okay. Well, I have a question, but before that, if with your indulgence, I'd like to share. Sorry, I was late. If you had been raised by Noeleen early on, please forgive me. I was at the Middle East conference just now and talking about crisis, Syria. And after that, Dr. Riaz Hassan was there with me too, talking about US relations with Asia. And guess who was the speaker? It was the Assistant Secretary, State Department, and is Ms. Diwal, a lady. So she's Asian, but head Assistant Secretary to the State Secretary in America. That says a lot. But the point I want to, the comment I'd like to make, so I never felt so great about women, role of women in Singapore, until the last few days, when Mr. Ban Ki-moon, twice, mentioned Noeleen's name. First was at SMU HRH lecture at Suntec City, And then later on at Istana, where he was conferred an honorary degree by NUS, and he never failed to mention the role of Noeleen Heyzer representing Singapore, not only representing Singapore, but representing the world. I think she deserves another round of applause. We are proud of you, Noeleen, and my question now is, I know I've been told that, in fact, women are normally brighter than men, even at universities, we were told that. And so my question is, how do you see our challenge of demography in Singapore? I think you know about problems about reproduction rate, and not enough babies, you know, and we have a lot of incentive schemes. How do you see that as a challenge for Singapore? And from your experience all over the world, how do you think we can try help to overcome that problem? Thank you.
My name is Elizabeth Lavin-Peter. I'm an academic advisor at the Overseas Family School here in Singapore. And part of my job is working with students who are thinking about going on to university and then to careers going forward. So I was wondering if you could just say a few words about your own pathway and how you made your way into the United Nations and to the position that you finally ended up in.
Okay, our Shirin Fozdar scholar.
Thank you very much. My name is Anne. I'm a year one student in SMU School of Business. Because I'm just came to Singapore, so I would like to ask, what are the major issues that Singaporean women are facing? And how can I, as an international student, contribute to doing good to the community and to women particularly? Thank you.
Right. Yes.
Hi, my name is Amu, and I'm co-founder and chief operating officer of Da Vinci Group, a company that deals with social transformation and education for children, teens, adults, and the elderly, as well as a member of the Young Women's Leadership Connection. So my question to you, Noeleen, I mean, it was so inspiring, and you've seen so much. So in your moments of despair, what did you look to actually cause the change and transformation that you have in your pathway? Thank you.
And one last question, perhaps, from Trina, and we'll take... Oh, so, and then, yes, of course, Mrs. Yufu Yishun. So two last questions. Trina,
hi,
first.
My name is Trina. You know, first, we're so proud of you, Noeleen, for representing us in the international community in such a distinguished manner. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge the amazing women here. Dr. Kanwalja is here, Claire, oh my gosh, it's just amazing. My question is very similar. You know, now you've taken some time to be in Singapore, welcome home. What do you see as the most pressing issues in Singapore, given that we are probably ranked one of the top societies for women, from the United Nations to so many other ranking tables. The other question I have is, what role can we play in the region, given that there's so many other pressing women's issues? Can we play it in a more structured way? I think your experience in you know, really bringing together so many groups of people, is there something that you are going to do now in Singapore in the next few years to really galvanize all of us in the women's movement? Thank you.
Noeleen, I want to ask a more international question. Just now you mentioned about CEDAW, maybe not many ladies, young ladies here know that. When we make the first CEDAW report, so I should say that UN had done a lot. So when we present the first CEDAW report, and I still remember that one question was, why there is different benefit between the male and female civil servant? The answer given by the PSD to me, I'm going to represent government, he said, because man is the head of the household. I said, I'm not going to attend the UN present this report. They're going to throw me the shoes, you know. So finally, I think, so anyway, cut it short. What I'm trying to say is that UN really done a lot for us to supervise the various issues among the government. There's local issue. But international issue, I'm sure all of you watch news every day about CNN and BBC and so on. Sometimes it's very confused. Of course, we know what is right, what is wrong. But you see the way the Russian, the Syrian, American, and so on, bomb here, bomb there. So I'm sure the young people, those young people have blood and have thinking and enthusiasm. They see what happened to the people. So what do you expect them to respond? So just now you said that they can use computer to self-recognition and so on. But how do you stop that when you see the facts happening every day? And another question is that today, if you observe that some of the big country behavior, so what is a UN challenge to make sure that everyone still observe the international law and regulation? Thank you.
So just let me pick on maybe just two or three, because I don't have much time to answer, but I think some of them require some meaningful answers. I think in terms of the demography, demography is indeed changing. Huh? In some countries, you have the youth bulge, but it can be turned into despair if we do not actually provide jobs for our young people. And today, globally, 73 million young people do not have jobs. And you can talk about your technological disruption and so on, but it's extremely serious. And if you can't give a future to your young, what do you expect them? Where do you think your young people would actually go? And if you don't give them hope in terms of mobility because of the rising inequalities, what do you expect your young people to actually go? And then on top of that, you have also an aging population. And unless you have... you deal with the with your dependency ratio, right? With the ratio. Now, less and less young people have to support a growing aging population. So what are you, how on earth are you going to pass a more sustainable, inclusive, hopeful world to your young people? And it is absolutely serious. And then if you continue in some countries in Asia with your sex selection, abortion and all that, there are not enough women to marry, yeah? So you have trafficking, and you have all kinds of people actually going across borders in order to support older men, okay, in the rural areas. So these are all very serious problems. I think we need to take the demographic challenge very seriously. Thank you so much for asking that question, and thank you for being so generous with me. The other, the pathway one, I'll talk about kind of later on, and then, but let me talk about... your point, Yishun, I think is an extremely important point. You know, you look at your media every day, and you can't run away from that. We may be thinking, all right, we have a relatively stable society and so on, but we could be an island of prosperity in the sea of instability, yeah, with tidal waves and so on. And of course, people feel vulnerable, and of course, they feel very much kind of uncertain. But who is going to manage our world? Where is the global governance and the commitment? Because so many of our member states, I mean, the UN, as I said, was created in 1945, right? And the problems and the conflicts that they have been handled were 20th century conflicts, where there were like interstate conflict or even civil conflict, but you have clear identities and you can negotiate at the negotiating table. Many of today's conflicts, you can't even negotiate on the everyday, on the usual table. And furthermore, precisely because it is so amorphous, you don't even know who are your enemies and where are they coming from. And it can be anyone. In fact, this Rwanda case was a case of neighbors becoming killers, right? Whereby if you begin to have hate speech, you can actually convert your neighbors into killers. This is what happened in some of the communities in Myanmar. I wouldn't go into it, but communities and neighbors that you used to live with suddenly become killers. So in a sense, there is that very deep sense of insecurity and vulnerability that we need to handle. The problem is that whilst the landscape has changed, the architecture of response
have remained the same and has not changed. So the UN with the P5, with the superpowers, each one taking care of their own self-interest, is not very helpful. And that's why a reform agenda is so critical, and not just the reform of the UN. I think we have to reform the whole response architecture to humanitarian crises, as well as to the conflicts that we have seen. And we have to involve more and more the local communities, the local players, and to expand this idea that it's only the institutions that can make things happen. I think we have to mobilize our citizens. I think all of us, there was some question of what is it we can do. We all have to be stakeholders. We all have to be stakeholders in a world whereby insecurity is spreading through the internet and so on. And we need to bring out greater positive hope, and also to make sure that these, the hope and the promises made by our governments are indeed implemented. And the other point is that not all governments are like our government here, right? I mean, a lot of our governments, I am very sorry to actually say, are not accountable governments. And many people are so disillusioned with traditional political leadership. And many of them, and many of the government's leaders, are there for power or for self-enrichment. And therefore, you can see a huge divide between governments and their people. So I think that as a society, as a global society, and in terms of global governance, we cannot allow our governments to get away with things in the UN. I mean, because there you have moral authority. So I think the use of the moral authority and a bit of the shaming, and this is where CEDAW comes in. I mean, because you have these frameworks are not just there, okay? These frameworks is actually to hold people accountable, and to have peer shaming or peer, acknowledgement of that things have actually gotten better and so on. And you are so aware of the type of questions which will be asked, and therefore you begin to change internally. And I think that we should not, and our leaders should not be, even if you don't want to do it in public, but they should not mince their words. You know, if there is a corrupt leader, for heaven's sake, name the person and take the person to task, even if it's within your four walls, so that they know that it's not just about them, but they are a danger to global and regional and national stability. And because at the end of the day, that breaks trust. I mean, you break trust. And the worst thing that can happen in human world today is the breakdown of trust. And I feel that there is a trust deficit that has got to be built back. And until we build that up in all kinds of ways, using the norms and standards which we have as the ethical frame to move us forward, then only will humanity have a more secure and sustainable future, including in our private sector.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And I think that's a very high note for us to end this. I think you will agree with me that it has been an amazing afternoon with Dr. Noeleen Heyzer. And you will see that why she says that she needs another 6 to 7 days to address all the questions that have been raised. You know, the work that Noeleen has done is amazing. It's been wonderful for individual human beings, and it's been wonderful for communities, societies, and countries. The work that she's done has been amazing, not because she's a woman, but because of the work that she's done in and of itself. And I just want to end off by saying something, by sharing a quote, since we're in an academic institution, sharing a quote from the fairly recently appointed Vice Chancellor of Oxford University, the first woman Vice Chancellor in 800 years. And she said, when she was interviewed, that she looks forward to the day when a woman being appointed is not in itself news. Right? I want to end on that note. I invite you to join me in thanking Dr. Noeleen Heyzer for an insightful, inspiring afternoon.
Thank you, Dr. Heyzer and Professor Kong. And thank you all for the active participation. As a token of our appreciation, we would like to invite Mr. Ho Kwon Ping, Chairman of SMU Board of Trustees, on stage to present a gift to Dr. Heyzer and Professor Kong. Thank you. We will now like to invite Professor Arnold De Meyer, President of SMU, to deliver his closing address.
Chairman, Dr. Noeleen Heyzer, Claire, what can I say after such an great speech? I feel very humble here standing in front of you, also knowing that I'm in between you and the food. But I do want to say a few words of thanks. I'm really humbled and encouraged by seeing so many of you here in this room. I remember that when we sort of planned for the first Shirin Fozdar lecture, that we sort of said, which room will we take? One of the smaller seminar rooms or the one that takes 40 people? But of course, with the ambition of Claire, we immediately go for the amphitheater. And I just want to put a challenge. Next year, we will have a 1,400-seater in our School of Law. As I said, I wanted to actually make 3 points. The first point is, of course, a great word of thanks to Noeleen, Dr. Noeleen Heyzer, for delivering this very inspiring and passionate speech. I was thinking, can we actually elect her for president? I'm not saying for what, but that I leave to you to think about. But it's really inspiring for me. And I wrote down a few points that I don't pretend to make a summary of what you said, but sort of I was very impressed by the overview of the sort of the history of how women have evolved and how the position of women has evolved over the years. And I was actually reminded of the fact of my mother, and that goes back a long time in time, as you can see, that's quite a while ago. But I remember that I was actually sent to the not-so-good school in the village or in the town where I was living, because the very good school where I was supposed to go was frowning about on the fact that my mother actually was pursuing a professional career and was not staying at home. And because she was not staying at home, I couldn't go to a good school. It's a very minor detail, and I made it, by the way. I sort of, I'm not suffering from it, but it's a minor detail that shows that even in those days in Europe, it was very not well accepted or not at all accepted that women would have a successful professional career. The second point that I picked up from what you said and that stuck with me, Noeleen, is that there is still this big gap and perhaps even bigger gap in Asia in terms of what women can achieve. And there's a phrase that stuck in my mind is, poverty has a woman's face. I think I'm not going to have good sleep tonight over that, because it really stuck me in my mind. And also, what I then found a very positive side to it is that you basically showed to many younger people in this room that you can make a difference. You did it by joining the United Nations and by saying, we're not going to sit in our office there in the United Nations and telling the world what to do. We're going to do something about it. We are going to take action. We will make change, radical change, even if it is necessary, and by using our moral authority, but actually going into the field, as you could see from the women. And I'm very impressed what you have achieved in your action against violence against women. But what I thought was really interesting there is also that you pointed out that actually women's rights made a big step in the progress the moment you defined women's rights as human rights. And the moment you did that, it is not about values, it is not about what can women contribute to society, it is about rights. And I think that is a very important point. I also realize that the work is incomplete. And so for the younger women and men in this room, I'm actually that second wing of that bird, if you remember, right? For the younger men and women in this room, there is a lot to be achieved in the future. And the last point that I wrote down here as sort of a point that really struck me when you were speaking, Noreen, was a women's position in a society is an indicator of the state of governance of a society. And I think that is very true. So that was the first thing I wanted to do, that was thank you for all these insights. I learned something tonight, so this is a very good day. The second thing that I want to do is thank Claire for the energy and ambition with which she has pushed SMU to make sure that Shirin Fozdar program is a successful program. You push us, you give us ambition, but at the same time you help us a lot. So without your help and without your ambition, this would not be possible, and I would like to ask a warm round of applause for Claire. I'm not going to speak about SMU in general, but the third point that I wanted to make is that the Shirin Fozdar program for me is a very important program as president because it fits so well in my deep belief about the value of diversity in a university as ours and the value of inclusion. I'm very happy that through the Shirin Fozdar program, we can actually sort of have a second axis or a third axis or whatever in fulfilling this dream that I have of having a university where everybody feels comfortable. And therefore, I'm so happy that through the Shirin Fozdar program, we have our two female SMU undergraduate students coming from outside Singapore, that we have been able to confer the Shirin Fozdar fellowship to two of our faculty to support meaningful research that will hopefully make a difference in women's lives. We're looking forward to your results next year, right? and I say this as a member of the audience, not as the president, to just be clear. I know that we are organizing these conferences on the move where we explore what's going on in Singapore. I know that we are actually supporting some of our students in some of their overseas research community service and local community service projects that have to do with diversity and inclusion. But finally, also, I'm very happy that perhaps as a first institution in Singapore, we're setting up a diversity and inclusion award to celebrate and recognize significant and innovative contributions by individuals or groups to the enhancement, support, and advancement of diversity and inclusion on campus and in the community. It's a mouthful, but it is also indicating that it's not only for our students, it is actually for Singaporeans and Singapore citizens and people living in Singapore. Of course, I hope it's a Singaporean who wins, and somebody from SMU, right? but that tends the competitive atmosphere that I like for this university from time to time. But once again, thank you also, you, our guests of honor, here tonight for this session. I hope to have that you will have a great weekend, that you have a great evening, but actually that not only you've learned something today, but that actually we will see you back next year or at some of the other activities of the Shirin Fozdar program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Demir, for the cogent and interesting summary. Your leadership will give us a strong push towards building a resilient and inclusive society. We have come to the end of the lecture. On behalf of SMU and the Shirin Fozdar Program Advisory Board, I would like to thank all of you for your presence this afternoon. And we look forward to your participation in our upcoming SFP events. For more information, please do visit the SFP website as shown on the screen. We would like all of you to enjoy the refreshment and get to know some friends. I wish you all a pleasant evening, and we hope to see you at the next SFP event. Thank you.